Kyle as we come to witness them being ordained as deacon and to pray for them as well. In a moment's time, the procession will come out and the ordinands will take a seat. But before they do that, I just wanted to bring a few notices to your attention just to make the service run smoothly and a few matters of housekeeping, things like that. Particularly with toilets, our main block of toilets are kind of off limits at the moment, but there are two toilets if you do need them. One of them is just through the door here on my left, your right, and then the other one is back out in the entrance. So if you do go out towards the entrance, somebody will direct you. I also just bring your attention to the notices on page 5 of your order of service, which outlines some of the social distancing measures that are in place just to ensure the service runs not only smoothly, but also in a way that is COVID compliant as well. Things like face masks being worn unless you have an exemption. We're trying to adhere to the 2 meter social distancing. Communion will be given later on in the service, but only in one kind. And Bishop Julian will direct later on in the service. After the service is finished, I am delighted that the sun is shining in Preston, which cannot be taken for granted. And as you exit the building, you can go this way. There's a one-way system in operation, and then out into the yard at the back there and enjoy some of the sunshine and congratulate those who you have come to support and pray for. That's all from me. The rest of the procession will be coming soon, and do enjoy the service, and take care.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
There is one body and one spirit.
And there is one hope to which we were called.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Would the processional party please be seated and join with others? And as I issue my welcome to everybody, thank you all for being here this afternoon. This is the fourth of the ordination services this weekend. There are others happening this afternoon, and by the end of today, there will have been 7 different ordination services for deacons and priests in the Diocese of Blackburn, and 23 men and women being commissioned, released by God into public Christian ministry. So it's a really exciting weekend for us. So thank you for coming to be here to support. I'm sorry it's such strange arrangements, having to wear masks and sit distantly from one another, but we'll try and make it as personal and as real as we can as we go through the service. I'll not wear a mask as I lead, but when I come to the moment of ordination, I will. And when I come to the moment of administration of Holy Communion, I will wear my mask. And I'll try to preach without my mask, but you wearing a mask, so I'm able to see what you're thinking as I preach. It's very unnerving preaching when you can't see whether people are laughing, smiling, or grimacing. So express with your eyes and give me a bit of a message if I'm going on too long or off-piste altogether. I think that's all we need to say by word of notices at this stage, but a particular welcome to Kyle, to Dan, and to Andy. Well done for making it to this moment in your lives, but also in this day, getting here today for this service. And be assured of our love and our prayers, not only for this service, but for the ministry that God is calling you to exercise in the name of Christ, here on in. God calls his people to follow Christ and forms us into a royal priesthood, a holy nation, to declare the wonderful deeds of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. The church is the body of Christ, the people of God, and the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. In baptism, the whole church is summoned to witness to God's love and to work for the coming of his kingdom. To serve this royal priesthood, God has given a variety of ministries. Deacons are ordained so that the people of God may be better equipped to make Christ known. Theirs is a life of visible self-giving. Christ is the pattern of their calling and their commission, as he washed the feet of his disciples, so they must wash the feet of others.
And so now I present the candidates to you, Bishop Julian, and to the congregation. I present Andrew Dykes to serve here in the parish of Preston Minster. Daniel Freeman to serve in the parish of Preston the Risen Lord. And Kyle Mulholland to serve in the parish of Ansdell and Fairhaven, St. Paul. To be ordained to the office of deacon in the Church of God.
Thank you for your presentation. Have those whose duty it is to know these ordinands and examine them found them to be of godly life and sound learning?
They have.
Do they believe them to be duly called to serve God in this ministry?
They do.
A question for you three candidates. Do you believe that God is calling you to this ministry? Thank you. I now invite the Archdeacon to confirm that the ordinands have taken the necessary oaths and made the declaration of assent.
Indeed so. At the ordination retreat in the cathedral on Friday, the candidates duly took the oath of allegiance to the sovereign and the oath of canonical obedience to the bishop. And they have affirmed and declared their belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formularies of the Church of England bear witness.
Let's now hold a moment's quiet as we pray for Kyle, for Dan, and for Andy, and for the ministry of the whole people of God. God our Father, Lord of all the world, through your Son you've called us into the fellowship of your universal church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry each may be an instrument of your love. And give to your servants now to be ordained, Kyle, Dan, and Andy, the needful gifts of grace. Through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Can this be seated, and invite Sam to come read our first... Oh, no, somebody else for our first reading. Thank you.
This is a reading from the book of Genesis. Jacob left Beersheba and went towards Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and to your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south, and all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and in your offspring. Know that I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel reading. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory
to you, O Lord. When Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him, he said of him, here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. Nathanael asked him, where did you come to know me? Jesus answered, I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you. Nathanael replied, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus answered, do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
As we stand, let us pray. Grant, Lord, we ask that your word indeed may be our rule, your Holy Spirit may be our teacher, and your greater glory, our supreme concern, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. God is and always has been in the business of calling, gathering, and forming teams of men and women who will do his bidding and further his cause here on earth. This weekend, as I've mentioned earlier, God is releasing 23 men and women into parishes around Lancashire. Three of those here this afternoon, and then three more later at the Priory in Lancaster. And we want to thank God for the journey that they have been on, for those who've helped and nurtured them in the faith in these years of training, for family and friends who've given them time to study and read and be away for residential weekends and all sorts of things, those who've supported them in the challenge of assessments, essays, interviews, placements, well, a whole host of other things, all part of that process of coming to today and now for those places where you've received an invitation to serve your curacy. That's exciting in itself. But what is also exciting is that you are part of a much bigger pipeline of candidates who are being selected and trained to follow in your footsteps. So some who are being ordained this weekend, but then others who are in the process and coming through the system. And not just in this diocese, but all around the country. David, our Archdeacon, the Archdeacon of Lancaster, sends his apologies for not being present at any of our ordinations this weekend, which is why Mark's had to traipse around after me in every single service, because David is speaking at the retreat and ordination services in Durham Diocese this weekend, and we wish and pray for him well in that exercise. And that's happening in all the dioceses around the country this weekend, or in the days nearby. God is definitely in the business of building a team. Some retire, so others begin to continue that work of proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ in this generation and then for future generations until the day when he returns. Now it's important to grasp that bigger picture and see that what we're doing this afternoon is part of a much larger story of God's plan for the salvation of the world. The growth of the church around the world at this time is remarkable. The resilience of those persecuted for their faith in Christ in other parts of the world is remarkable. And I want to say, I believe also that the Diocese of Blackburn's response to the current pandemic has also been remarkable, as people have coped with all the challenges that lockdown and our present circumstances have imposed upon us. And it's in that bigger, wider context that we focus on God's call to three individuals, to Kyle, to Dan, and to Andy, as they step up and as they step out to be deacons for this year in the Church of God. And while they've been prepared for this over a long period of time, and it's therefore no surprise that they're here, I want to suggest that there ought always to be that sense of surprise when we're dealing with God and his ways. I have to admit that I often wake up in the morning surprised to discover that I've been called to be a bishop. And I'm now in my 40th year of being a priest. That's another massive surprise. How on earth has that happened? How extraordinary is that? What a gracious act of God's mercy and kindness. It should be a constant surprise to all of us that we're loved by God and that we're called by God and useful in his service. Our Old Testament reading from Genesis tells how Jacob was surprised. What had started as an ordinary night, a kip in the open air with his head on a stone pillow, it's quite surprised that he actually drifted off enough to have a sleep in order to have a dream with a pillow like a stone. But he did. But it was a turning point in his life. And he exclaimed after his dream, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it." Complete surprise. Nathaniel had no idea when he started out that day, described in our gospel reading, that he would meet with Jesus, be known by him, and then affirm him, the first, in fact, to do so in the gospels, as the Son of God, and then be told that he would see greater things. No doubt at the end of the day, when he was putting his slippers on beside the fire and he was back home and reflecting what had happened during the day, he might easily have used the same words that Jacob used. "The Lord is in this place, and I did not know it." Complete surprise. And so it is and should be, I believe, with every encounter that men and women have with the God of the universe, where the supernatural breaks into the natural, where the extraordinary breaks into the ordinary, where heaven breaks into the affairs on earth. God is an interventionist God. The record of the scriptures make that abundantly plain. God can't keep himself back from trying to engage with the world that he loves. He can't help himself from trying to win and to woo men and women, hearts and minds of those he's created. Of course, the supreme intervention, I'm not sure it's a very theological word, intervention, but anyway, incarnation is. That is the big intervention. As John Betjeman put it in his poem, "God was man in Palestine." I mean, that's the remarkable surprise. And we get so used to Christmas and carols that we forget it's extraordinary that that should have taken place. And in this, there's a crucial message, I believe, for our candidates today and also for our church today. And it's that we should not confine or restrict God and his work to the purely and merely human, to our carefully crafted programs for reform and renewal, our courses, and even with Mark Ireland sitting here, might I say, our mission action plans, or our Vision 2026. Now, those are all important. They're all good initiatives. But we must allow God to have bigger plans, to intervene in ways beyond our planning. We must allow him to sometimes disrupt our plans because he's got a better plan, a different plan. And so our praying really matters. The scope of our praying, I believe, reveals the level of our expectation. There was a book written a long time ago. It was around when I was a student. Your God is too small. And I think for us as a church at the moment, our God is too small. I mean, he's not too small, but we make him too small. He is Almighty God, the creator of the universe, the redeemer of the world, and one day the judge of all kind. That is who he is. And so in the corridor outside the chapel at Bishop's House, there's a text on the wall: expect great things from God, attempt great things for God. The two go hand in hand. We can attempt great things for him when we expect great things from him. And of course, Jesus' own ministry was one that was full of surprises, as was that, of course, the story of the early church in the Acts of the Apostles, and I believe has been the history of the last 2,000 years. One surprise after another. And that's what we should expect of such a God. What is God doing today? Some people may ask. We don't see him or hear from him very much. Well, I think he's seeking people who will worship him in spirit and in truth. Jesus said, the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. The Good Shepherd is out on the hillside looking for the lost sheep. And deacons and priests are set apart from other duties and responsibilities to focus on that task of making Jesus more widely known, believed, and loved. So they're not promoters of the church, but Jesus. You're not promoters of the Church of England, but Jesus. You're not promoters of yourselves, but you are signposts to him. And if you can have as a focus in the ministry that God is calling you to, that focus of enabling others to have a Jacob or Nathaniel meeting with God, you won't go far wrong. May it be a ministry that's full of surprises. Expect surprises. Don't shut out the possibility of a dream or a vision, a clear prompting of the Spirit to say or do something. That's why we pray in our diocesan vision prayer, which we'll pray at the end of this service, that God will give us an eye to see and an ear to hear. Well, all of that requires us to be in close communion with our God and Father. That means daily times of meeting alone with him, reading and praying at the start of the day to receive your orders from headquarters, and then to keep in touch with HQ through the day. Church sometimes feels rather like a purely human institution. It is very human, and we all have discovered that. But it is a company of faithful people who've allowed and encouraged the power of God to be at work in the world. In one sense, God doesn't need us. He could just do it or say it. But in another, he's chosen to involve you and me in his purposes and calls us fellow workers. Well, we're unable to fulfill that calling to be the body of Christ on our own, which is why this service and ordained ministry focuses on the call to the Holy Spirit. Yes, we receive him when we become a Christian, but we need to be filled afresh with him day by day, that fresh empowering. And that's why when we come to the moment of ordination, I shall pray, send down the Holy Spirit. Because that's the only way that we can do what God has asked us to do. Only when we give that Spirit of God room to maneuver in our lives will we experience the surprises of God. Henry Nguyen, in the book The Dance of Life, put it like this: each day holds a surprise, but only if we expect it can we see, hear, or feel it when it comes to us. Let's not be afraid to receive each day's surprise, whether it comes to us in sorrow or as joy. It will be an open place in our hearts, a place where we can welcome friends and celebrate more fully our shared humanity. Somebody else has said, surprise is God's way of saying hello. Let's allow God to get through to us. And I pray that in the ministry that follows on from today's ordination, we will hear many stories of the way God has surprised you in your ministry, and that you will have stories to tell of how you've seen God surprise others because of your ministry as a deacon in the Church of Almighty God. Amen. So with the ordinands, please stand. Deacons are called to work with the bishop and the priests with whom they serve as heralds of Christ's kingdom. They're to proclaim the gospel in word and deed as agents of God's purposes of love. They're to serve the community in which they are set, bringing to the church the needs and hopes of all the people. They are to work with their fellow members in searching out the poor and the weak, the sick and the lonely, and those who are oppressed and powerless, reaching into the forgotten corners of the world that the love of God may be made visible. Deacons share in the pastoral ministry of the church and in leading God's people in worship. They preach the word and bring the needs of the world before the church in intercession. They accompany those searching for faith and bring them to baptism. They assist in administering the sacraments. They distribute communion and minister to the sick and the housebound. Deacons are to seek nourishment from the scriptures. They're to study them with God's people, that the whole church may be equipped to live out the gospel in the world. They are to be faithful in prayer, expectant, and watchful for the signs, the surprising signs of God's presence. We trust that you are fully determined by the grace of God to give yourself wholly to his service, that you may draw his people into that new life which God has prepared for those who love him. And now, in order that we may know your mind and purpose, you must make the declarations we put to you. Do you accept the Holy Scriptures as revealing all things necessary for eternal salvation through faith in Jesus Christ?
I do so accept them.
Will you be diligent in prayer, in reading Holy Scripture, and in all studies that will deepen your faith and fit you to bear witness to the truth of the gospel? Do you believe the doctrine of the Christian faith as the Church of England has received it? And in your ministry, will you expound and teach it?
I believe it and will so do.
Will you strive to make the love of Christ known through word and example and have a particular care for those in need? you be a faithful servant in the household of God, after the example of Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve.
By the help of God, I will.
When you endeavour to fashion your own life and that of your household according to the way of Christ, that you may be a pattern, an example to Christ's people.
By the help of God, I will.
Will you work with your fellow servants in the gospel for the sake of the kingdom of God?
By the help of God, I will.
Will you accept the discipline of this church and give due respect to those in authority?
By the help of God, I will.
Will you then, in the strength of the Holy Spirit, continually stir up the gift of God that is in you to grow in holiness and grace? The congregation now please stand, and the candidates turn and face the congregation. This is the significant moment in the service where if you want to go home quickly, you can say you don't support them as candidates and we can just finish everything and go home. But I'm trusting that's not going to be how you'll respond. Let's affirm them with our support, our love and our prayers. Brothers and sisters, you've heard how great is the charge that these ordinands are ready to undertake. And you've heard their declarations. Is it now your will that they should be ordained?
It is.
Will you continually pray for them?
We will.
Will you uphold and encourage them in their ministry?
We will.
Let's turn and face me again as ordinands. In the name of our Lord, we bid you remember the greatness of the trust in which you are now to share, the ministry of Christ himself, who for our sake took the form of a servant. Remember always with thanksgiving that the people among whom you will minister are made in God's image and likeness. In serving them, you are serving Christ himself, before whom you will be called to account. You cannot bear the weight of this calling in your own strength, but only by the grace and power of God. Pray, therefore, that your heart may be daily enlarged and your understanding of the Scriptures enlightened. Pray earnestly for the gift of the Holy Spirit. I should be seated, candidates, to kneel, and the ancient prayer for the Holy Spirit, come Holy Ghost, will be played for us and sung for us, because we're not allowed to sing here in church.
Thank you.
continue in prayer as Alistair McAfee, the Erudine, leads us in the words of the litany.
In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all the members of the Church in their vocation and ministry, that they may serve him in truth and love, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Julian, Philip, and Jill, our bishops, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may hunger for truth and thirst after righteousness, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Andrew, Daniel, and Kyle, called to be deacons in his church, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness we may proclaim the gospel of reconciliation to the ends of the earth, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the unity of the church, that we may be one in Christ according to his will, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who do not yet believe, that they may receive the light of the gospel, and for those whose faith has grown cold, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the sick and suffering, for the aged and infirm, for the lonely and neglected, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the poor and the hungry, for the homeless and the oppressed, for all prisoners and captives, and for our brothers and sisters who are persecuted for their faith, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Elizabeth, our Queen, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For ourselves, for grace to repent and amend our lives, that we may be pardoned and absolved from all our sins, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. And remembering all who have gone before us in faith, and in communion with Michael and all the saints, we commit ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our God. To you, O Lord.
We continue in an attitude of prayer as we come to the ordination prayer. We praise and glorify you, Almighty Father, because in your infinite love you have formed throughout the world a holy people for your own possession, a royal priesthood, a universal church. We praise and glorify you because you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to take the form of a slave. He humbled himself for our sake and in obedience accepted death, even death on a cross. We praise and glorify you because in every age you send your Spirit to fill those whom you've chosen, to equip your holy people for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. And now, we give you thanks that you have called these your servants, Andy, Dan, and Kyle, whom we ordain in your name to share as deacons in the ministry of the gospel of Christ. Therefore, Father, Through Christ our Lord, we pray. Send down the Holy Spirit on your servant Andy for the work of a deacon in your church. Amen. Send down the Holy Spirit on your servant Andy for the office and work of a deacon in your church. Oh, sorry, wrong name. Well, there we are. We'll just have to... So you've been ordained deacon twice. Let's start again. Sorry about that. Send down the Holy Spirit on your servant Dan for the office and work of a deacon in your church. Amen. Send down the Holy Spirit on your servant Kyle for the office and work of a deacon in your church. Amen. Through your Spirit, Heavenly Father, give these your servants grace and power to fulfill their ministry. Make them faithful to serve and constant in advancing your gospel in the world. May they follow the example of Jesus Christ, your Son, who washed the feet of his disciples and set the needs of others before his own. May their life be disciplined and holy, their words declare your love, and their actions reveal your glory, that your people may walk with them in the way of truth and be made ready for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, to whom, with you and your Holy Spirit, belong glory and honor, worship and praise, now and forever. Amen. And so, with the deacons, please stand. Okay. Receive your license and this book. Receive this license and your book, this book. Receive your license and this book. Receive these books as a sign of the authority given you this day to speak God's word to his people, build them up in his truth, and serve them in his name. We welcome you as fellow servants in the gospel, that Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you may be rooted. If they can turn around so they can be seen. Face this way so we may be reminded of our unity in Christ. We are all one in Christ Jesus. We belong to him through faith, heirs of the promise of the Spirit of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Share the peace, but without doing it sort of in a way that's going to cause trouble or the spread of the virus. So a look, a glance, a sort of a nod, a wave, whatever, in order to show some that sense of God's peace with each other. It's interesting how we have to go through this process of washing our hands or cleansing our hands. Actually, what God wants more than clean hands is clean hearts. And that's what he came into the world to die for, that we might have a clean and a pure heart. Let's be praying that for one another and for Kyle and Dan and Andy's ministry here on in. Be present, Lord Jesus Christ, our risen High Priest, and make yourself known in the breaking of bread. Amen. It's our privilege to be able to say, the Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
'Tis our right and good, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks and praise through your servant, Jesus Christ, our Lord. At his baptism, he was revealed as your beloved Son. Coming among us as one who serves, he taught us that the greatest in your kingdom are those who make themselves least and the servant of all. Although he was their teacher and their Lord, he washed the feet of his disciples and commanded us to do the same, that we might reveal the power of your love made perfect in our human weakness. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying without a choir, Holy, 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 God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Same way after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption as we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Would you please be seated as we share together in praying the prayer Jesus taught his first disciples and which has been prayed by Christians down through the centuries and all around the world. And so, that great company of brothers and sisters, we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. So we draw near with faith to receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for us. We eat in remembrance that he died for us, and we feed on him in our hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. there is so distance, I shall bring communion to where people are seated. Let us pray. Holy and blessed God, you have fed us with the body of your Son and filled us with your Holy Spirit. May we honor you not only with our lips, but in lives dedicated to the service of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. And we join in the diocesan vision prayer with that special emphasis on eyes to see and ears to hear the prompting of the Spirit. So we pray. Heavenly Father, we embrace your call for us to make disciples, to be witnesses, and to grow leaders. Give us eyes to see your vision, ears to hear the prompting of your Spirit, and courage to follow in the footsteps of your Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Would you please stand? God, who has called you, is faithful. May the Father, whose glory fills the heavens, cleanse you by his holiness and send you to proclaim his word. Amen. May Christ, who ascended to the heights, pour upon you the riches of his grace. Amen. May the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, equip you and strengthen you in your ministry. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of you, those you love, those for whom you pray, this day and forevermore. Amen. And so we go in the light and the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.
This cornerstone, this solid